Hello everyone, today we will study about virus, worms and other malwares. These are the malicious programs usually used by attackers to harm the system. So let's see how these malicious programs harms the system and what are the characteristics of each malicious programs. So first one is virus. Virus usually harms the files and it spreads from one file to another file. So usually this virus code may be prepended or appended to the host file. This virus code usually it is embedded inside the host file and it may be embedded in the starting of the file or it may be embedded in the last of the file here. Whenever you open that infected host file, it executes that virus code, whatever it is embedded, that virus code it executes first and it seeks for all other files which are uninfected files and it affects all those files and all those files also now become as infected files here. So now in viruses also there are two types of viruses. One is malicious virus. Malicious virus it harms the files. How? By deleting or by adding the nice or modifying the files here. And another one is the innocuous virus. This innocuous virus it is harmless virus and simply it spreads from one file to another file. Usually just it try to affect the host file by printing as a hello world message here. And whenever this virus code affects the host file, after that it starts scattered inside that particular file using the jump statement. For that, what is the thing it will do now? First, the code is splitted as a segments and each segment is spread throughout the file as a virus segment and using the jump statement. And each segment is like as a one virus and that segment you can transfer to another file. Little segment of the virus file is enough to affect that particular old file. In this way, it spreads the single virus code as a multiple virus code and it affects the multiple files here. Okay, so now after infecting the files, usually your original file, whatever the file is there, no, that file size and this infected file, if you compare, no, this infected file size is larger. So usually antiviruses, they search the viruses based on the file size only. If file size is larger than the original file, meaning of that one is what? Yes, this file is infected file. So then it doesn't allow that file to open. Once if you are open, no, it spreads to the all other files in that particular system. So this one is known by the attackers. That's why what they used one technique, that is what you call as a compression. Compression means what? First they will see the size of the virus and up to that size it compress the original file and remaining part of the size it is added as a virus code, then your original file size remains as it is. Assume that for the file, original file is having the size of 20 MB. And this virus code is of 5 MB. Then what is the thing they will do now? Attackers, first they will compress. Compress means what it is? Your original file is reduced to 15 MB and it embeds that 5 MB virus code to that 15 MB file. Now that original file becomes what? 20 MB only. In this way, it avoids from the antivirus to detect such type of the file here. This is one of the nature of the virus file, but that one they can modify using this compression here. And even in the virus also they set of system calls they make. Usually you already know that system calls means these are the calls usually used by application programmers to request for the services from the operating system. That may be read or write the file or establish the TCP connection like that. So in the same way, viruses also set the system calls as a request service to operating system to edit or modify a registry. Windows registry you can also modify by setting as a system call, and whenever the operating system reads this request as a service, then it may be changes the your Windows registry. And even also it adds a system call tells that it own file, you make the multiple copies of the this virus infected file. That is also request may be sent by this viruses by setting as a system calls here, or it may call that is scan the emails. What are the emails you will get? No, all those emails you can scan like that. Even it sets the system calls to get the service from the operating system. In this way, viruses affect the files here. Okay, in particular system, it harms the individual system. In individual system, how many files are there? Those files are harmed by this particular virus here. Next one is the worms. It is very dangerous, whereas it worm spreads from one system to another system. Here it affects the systems, whereas in the virus it spreads and it affects only the individual files. Okay, based on the files only it affects. That file may be modified or that file may be deleted, but it is not like that. It harms the system here. Okay, so first we'll see the characteristics of the worm. So first one is enhanced targeting. Enhanced targeting means what it is. Now worms want to infect the system now. So for that it has to search the victims here. For searching that we call as a enhanced targeting. Target means what? Searching for the victim. So first victim is your email. So it go to the mailbox and email address book. There you will get the different types of the different users mail address. With the help of those mail addresses, it affects from one system to another system. This is one way of searching for the victims. And next one is your mobile. So in the mobile you will get the mobile numbers in your contact details. So in this way it affects the or spreads from one system to another system. This device may be computer or may be mobile here. Next one is the IP address of the system. MAC address, IP address. So IP address is how it will get. One is it's continuously scan the internet. Okay, so now continuously it scan the internet to check for the vulnerable machines. Vulnerable machines means what? Yes, we can easily attack the those systems. Some loopholes may be there in that particular machine. So that's why we can easily attack the those systems. So usually worms will search for the such type of the system only. Any loopholes is there and it is easy to attack such type of the systems we call as machines, we call as a vulnerable machine, and worms will usually search for such type of the machines here through the IP address. That IP address by scanning through the internet. Or one more is there, randomly it generates using random function, randomly generates the IP addresses, and based on that IP addresses it affects the your machine. So one more is the harvesting of the URL. Harvesting of the URL means what? It continuously monitor the browsing history of the all the users, continuously which URL everyone is browsing, then what are the content is there in that particular URL. No, so that content it creates its own website, and in that website it get the inform, it adds the information in such a way that easily you can get the information other than going to that particular VRL, virtual VRL. So in this way it attacks the all the users or divert the user to use that particular website, and based on that it get the or attack the all the victims as a machines here. This is the one more way of the targeting here. So one more is that for 80% of victims are that I'll send my network address, whoever having my red network address, for all those machines I can attack here. So in this way it search for the targets. To whom? Targets is nothing but the victims, which machines are easily available to make as an attack here. Next is enhanced speed. Enhanced speed means what? In how, in which speed will spread from one system to another system. That is one machine to another machine. In how fast you can spread, that is what you call as enhanced speed. So here worms are developed in such a way that it spans in multiple threads. Okay, in multiple threads, if it spans means what it is, you can imagine simultaneously it can attack the more than one machine at a time here. So now for this one thing it uses the procedure. For example, buffer overflow vulnerability machine. It search for the buffer overflow vulnerability machine. Overflow problem when it comes, if it is takes the more time to get to the or reply to the acknowledgement or any process, what are the process this takes, no, takes place, no, it takes the more time here. So in that time, what is the thing it will do? No, usually you are using the TCP for communication. That TCP is connection oriented and it uses the three-way handshake, which one is longer. So now in that time, in the place of TCP, it uses the UDP to attack the those vulnerable machines here. So now in the connection less, easily you can spread here. Okay, so if it is connection oriented, it takes time to spread here. So that's why in the place of TCP, it uses connection less UDP and it increases the speed of spreading the your worms here. This is the one more way of spreading the things here. And another one is the it generates a hit list. Hit list by enhanced targeting, it already know that what are the vulnerable machines that one I can affect. Okay, so those we call as a victims, and though all the machine as a victim machines are listed as a hit list, and that hit list it maintains, and whenever it attacks it spreads, no, so based on that hit list at a time simultaneously it attacks. And one system if it is attacked by the worms, then what is the thing it will do? No, that hit list it divides. Okay, and it's half part of the hit list it sent to the that infected machine, and that infected machine what it makes, that hit list, based on that hit list it affects the remaining machines. Like that it spreads the worms to the from one machine to another machine. So in this way it increases the speed of spreading the worms here. Next one is the enhanced capabilities. Enhanced capabilities, as we know that for all the systems you are having the unique IDs or distinct IDs, in the same way for the viruses and worms also you are having the unique IDs or distinct IDs. So based on that we can identify this is this type of the worm and this is this type of the virus here. So now that is it usually uses the signatures. Okay, IDs are like the signature. It generates the signature for every worms and by every virus, and based on those things it spreads from one system, one machine to another machine here. Even it uses the encryption also. What are the worm code you are having? No, it hides that worm code from the others here. So that's why instead of sending that code as it is, if any user access, they will read and they will get to know that this is the procedure they are using to spread from or harm the computers, and it spreads from one system to how. Okay, one computer to another computer, how it is spreading. If they care, anyone see that code, they will understand and they will make the precaution to avoid to such type of the attacks here. That's why instead of sending the worms as it is, it encrypts the worm code also. As you know that for encrypting you require the keys here. So for all the worm code, if you are encrypted using a one key, then you call as a simply worms. If you are for any every encryption, if you are using the different keys, then you call that one as a polymorphic worm here. Okay, and next one is metamorphic worm. Metamorphic worm means what it is. Now what are the version you are having? No, so that version may be having the lifetime is less here. So that's why it takes the multiple versions of the same worms here. So multiple versions worms, what it is contains, usually multiple versions worms with the spurious instructions. Okay, that worms contains a very spurious instructions, so that's why it makes confuse the detection softwares. Okay, when we are having the so many antivirus softwares are there, those softwares will detect the worms here. So once that particular worm is detected, then what is the thing we will do now? We'll go for the higher version of that worm, and in higher version we'll add the suspicious instructions in such a way that even it confuses your detection software also. So such type of the versions, whatever it goes, no, that one you call as a metamorphic worms. Metamorphic worms means what? Version, updation of the worms in the different versions here to confuse the detective softwares. And polymorphic worm means what it is? Instead of using one encryption key, you are using the multiple keys. And you may have the question that who will decrypt that? So as here for that code, even in the encryption code, even it writes the decryption code also in that particular worm code. It contains encrypted, and also for decrypting that one, what are the code you require? No, that code is also embedded inside that particular worm file here. Okay, so whenever it opens, so automatically it decrypts itself and it spreads to the whole computer here. Next one is enhanced destructive power. So if it attacks the system, what harms it makes to that particular system? One is, for example, it may reduce the speed of that particular machine here. That is the one way. Or important files in that particular, important documents, whatever it is stored in that particular machine, no, it may harm those important files. Or one more is, for example, for several businesses and enterprises, they are using their own software to run their business and enterprises. In that time, this worms will, what it makes, it harms the those softwares, or those softwares may be used by business or enterprises. If it harms, then business is not unable to run, because that software is what harm means, it is struck. So that business is unable to use that particular software. Because of that, they may cause the very high payload here. So that is what you call as enhanced destructive power. It is payload of that particular worm. How much it worms here? It cost how much for that particular machine? Okay, sometimes that machine may be dead also. So these are the some of the different types of the worms which already affected, and because of that heavy payload is also done by that particular system, machines, whatever machines or business or enterprises it is affected. That is Code Red, NIMDA and BT worm here. The different categories of the worms are internet scanning worms, email worms, P2P worms, web worms and mobile worms. We'll see one by one. Internet scanning worms, as I told earlier, so now if you want to get the victims, how we'll get the victims? First you scan the internet looking for vulnerable machines. So in the internet scanning worms, simply it scans the internet and it detects the targets the vulnerable machines here. And here what are the scanning worms are there? No, it is self-activated. Okay, not the human intervention is necessary here. When it detects, automatically it is attacked to that particular machine. So no machine, the human intervention is required here. And also I told earlier, it is what? For delivering this malicious payload to the victim, how it delivers? Through the two standard protocols. One is TCP and another one is the UDP. These are the two protocols it used to transfer the worms from one system to another system. Once this worms is installed on the victim machine, so what will it do? It erases the local files, steal the secrets or deface the web pages. Okay, like this it harms that particular victim if it is internet scanning worms here. So here for the internet scanning worms, two types of case studies are there. One is Code Red. It is started on June 18, 2001, and usually when a buffer overflow vulnerability is faced, then it is discovered, and Microsoft 2S web server. So it attacks the web server. Here victim is what? Web server. Web server is vulnerable due to the buffer overflow. So this one, it is scanned by the worm, and whenever it get to know that, so based on that it attacked. Okay, in 2001 worm is attacked the web server using what? HTTP request message. With the help of this message it attacked the web server here, and for based on that it generates the machine address. How it generated? Now random number generator. Based on the random number generator, it is getting the what is the address of the new machines to infect. Okay, once it is infected this web server, so next remaining machines it is infected based on this random number generator. And one more is the slammer. So it is 25th January 2003. It has infected the one of the Microsoft SQL Server 2000. Because of the reason is what? This is also vulnerable to buffer overflow here. And instead of using here HTTP, it used what? It is sent, the worm is sent the packets on UDP. UDP is connectionless. Spreading of the worms is more here. Next. Worm propagation model. Worm propagation model means what? How it spreads from one system to another system. What is the spreading rate? Based on what criteria it spreads? That analysis what you call as a worm propagation model. In the worm propagation model, first one is the simple epidemic model. So in the simple epidemic model, this is the equation they used, and based on that they analyze that. So if it is affected, so at a time how many systems it can harms here. Okay, so here in this equation N indicates total number of vulnerable host, and IT is individual host infected at a time T here, and this whole thing you call as a already infected. So this is already infected host. Okay, and N minus IT. So N minus IT, if it is you are using, means what? These are the number of suspectable host, means vulnerable host now. So it is susceptible to attack now by the worms here. And initial infection rate. At initial, what are the infection rate is there? So this is the equation used to check the initial infection rate. So next you are in interchanging your left and right. If you are interchanged, then you will get the equation like this. This 1 minus IT divided by N we call as a fresh infected count here. Here you are counting only already infected. How many are infected? Okay, now and at the current time, how many persons are infected? Sorry, how many host are infected? That one you call as a fresh infected. In this way, in the simple epidemic model, just you will check the what are the susceptible host and how many host are infected here. Okay. Next one is Kermack-McKendrick model. Kermack-McKendrick model. This is the one more model to analyze that how many host can be infected at a time using this worm here. And as I told here in SEM, simple epidemic model, there is only two stages. One is susceptible and another one is infectable. Infectable means what? Once if it is infected by the worms, then you are not considering that regarding about that. So you leave that part here. Okay. But here in the this Kermack-McKendrick model, so you are using the three phases. One is susceptible state S and infectious stage I. So that is infectious state means what it is, if they all they already those hosts are infected. Next one is the terminal. Terminal means what? Either that system is died or it may be recovered here. Okay, so these are the model, and here you are making the analysis based on the suspects. If it is infected, okay, how many are infected among the suspected host, and among the host infected, how many terminals or how many machines are recovered here. That one you can analyze here using this model here. And next one is the more realistic model is what it is. So here you are using the patch. Patch means what it is. Now it is suspected. So even when it is suspected, then only you will take the precaution measure to prevent from the affecting, okay, infecting. So then directly we'll go to the patch 2 here. Patch 2 is means you are not allowing that particular host to attack by the worm here. And one more is the same here, that it is infected. If it is infected, then you are using the, okay, how to overcome from that particular, that is you have to take the all those procedure. Either you can boot the system, or you can use the antiviruses, or you can use the detecting worm softwares. Based on that, you can clear those worms, or your system itself may be die here. Okay, so these are the more realistic model. So these are the three different models. These are the models you are using for which purpose? Okay, analyze the how speed that particular worm will spread. Next is the email worms. Email worms, as I told, here it spreads from one system to another system with the help of the email address book here. So now, for example, one sender want to send some mail to the receiver. That sender is genuine and receiver is genuine, and that file is also original host file. It is an uninfected file here. While transferring, this attacker will add the email worms here. That email worms is what? Software macros. Okay, for your message it adds the software macros. Okay, so software macros it adds, and whenever that receiver receive, they will see that only that is a original message here. So this software mac is embedded and it is hidden here. So whenever that particular system as a receiver open that one, so then what happens here? It attack to the that particular old machine here. Okay, so in this way one case has happened, that is what you call as a malicious was a worm, macro worm. At a time it can attack the 15 persons with the help of victim's email address book here. See here, if that particular macro worm, if it is there, if that person open that mail, within a second it attacks to the 50 person here. It spreads to the 50 person. How? By attacking their address book here. And one more best email worm is the most recent vintage is SoBig. SoBig is a last, it is used in 2013. How it is communicating? Using the email and copying itself to the open network share. It is open network share. Okay, for this one here you are having the networks of the open share networks. So there you will copy your malicious, and for the email, okay, what are the emails are there. So now for ads, all those things you will get. No, in those ads, what is the thing you will get? You will get all the so many person you want, more person you can get there. So such type of the things only you call as a open network share, and it copying itself from one address book to another, like this, from one person to another person. First it attacks the first victim, okay, machine, and whenever that person open, that machine is attacked and it transferred to the address book of the that particular machine. In that mail, how many address book are there? For all the address books, it attacks in the same way. And by likewise, it copying itself to spread from one machine to another machine with the help of their address books here. Okay, and as I told earlier, URLs, harvesting URLs. This is the one of the example, geocities.com. It is the URL which is usually used to create your own web. Okay, so web pages if you want to create, so this one is very easily available. And if you are follow this website, if you are follow this particular website, then you will easily create your own website here. So there is no effort. Just click on that particular thing, you will get the frame. And whenever you use those templates, and based on that, easily you can create the web pages. So then everyone will be easily attracted, and that to be free now. Okay, so then everyone will use this URL. So now this is absorbed by the attackers, and they attack this particular URL. Whenever any users click on this particular URL, that person or that machine is attacked here. P2P P2 pin warms here. So that is peer and node place. From one node to another node, we call it act as a client and server here. So usually it works for the sharing files. Which type of the files it is? Songs, images and videos. Okay. So now if you want to share the songs, images from one machine to another machine with the help of the peer nodes here. So in the peer nodes, for example, I am the client. I want to get some songs from the Genuine server here. But instead of going to access that particular server, this peer node. Peer node means what? If the any two nodes are having the TCP connection, then those two nodes we call as a peer nodes here. Okay, so now this client want to access the songs from the Genuine server where that song is available, but this peer node, when it is connected, instead of sending that request to that particular server, this peer node creates one sharing files. That file contains all those songs which are required by that particular client here. So then what is the thing we'll do now? This peer simply forward the sharing file to the client here. Whenever this client will access this sharing file, actually this sharing file contains what? It contains the worms here. So that client, if it opens, then automatically it attacks that particular client machine here. So now for attacking in this way, we call as a P2P worms here, peer-to-peer worms here. So in that also and two types. One of the simplest is for a malicious peer to respond positively to any queries. For any queries of the client, simple answers if you are respond, easily they can get the reply for their messages, then they will blame on that particular peer. And they always, whatever the things they want know, they will send a query to that peer node. And in this way, that peer will get the attention of the client and it afterwards it share the files. So that file contains the worms here. One more is the peers in a given P2P network run the same P2P protocol. So this one actually are in the two types. One is active and another one is passive. As I told, here this peer node creates a shared folder. Anyone, if you want any songs or any images or videos, yes, you can get this shared folder, and here all those documents are available. So then one way is client will send a request for the songs, then this peer will simply send that shared file to that particular client. Okay, when that client will open, it attacks here. This one you call as a passive. And one more is there, even client is not sent any request, but you are the peer, that shared file you are sharing to the all the clients. Okay, whoever comes under that particular node connection. So now for all the neighbors, it sends that particular file. Even they are not asked also. But whenever there is, you know, they will may open that particular file, then it attacks that particular client machine here. So that is you call as an active protocol. Next one is the web worms. Web worms is different from internet scanning worms. So it is based on the browser history. Okay, it is scanning the internet. In the internet, what are the things will come? No, that one it scans and it search for the vulnerable machine. But here it monitored the browser history, and based on the browser history, it attacked the vulnerable. It identify the vulnerable machines and it attacks. Usually web worms are written in high level language and it is easy to perform complex operation, but it is difficult to execute low level operations. Okay, so now here it is what? It is worms are written in the high level language, that's why it perform the all the complex operations also easily, but it doesn't support low level operations. So one type of the web worm is XSS worm. So this worm is called since it exploits cross-site scripting vulnerabilities in a web server. So here thing is what? One case study is there based on this XSS worm, that is the social networking site, that is the MySpace. So now in this social network, everyone can edit or create their files here. That profile contains all the details about the person, okay, whoever the members comes under in that particular network group, all person photographs and everything is available, like your Facebook. In the Facebook, all the person details we can get easily know. So like that, this MySpace is one of the social networking site is created, and it attracts the clients, and based on that profile, it attracts the different types of the clients. Next is mobile malware. So as we know that now we are using the smartphones. In the smartphone, easily you are having the so many rich of APIs which are available to access your phone books, files, send SMS, MS, whatever the things you want to do, know all those things easily you can do here. So now in the same way, what are the APIs are available in the mobile, this attacker will create their own APIs. Okay, that is used by the malware. For which purpose? To read your confidential documents. This API is what it is, a malware. That's why you are using as a mobile malware. And whenever you use this API, then automatically it reads all your confidential document. So in the mobile malware, one of the example is Bluetooth. That is communication technology and protocol stack. This Bluetooth you are using for two purpose, one for communication purpose and another for the protocol purpose. You already know what is Bluetooth. So now with the help of the Bluetooth also malicious, you can attack the your smartphones here. So for that you are using one concept, that is the discoverable mode here. Discoverable mode means what? As we already know that whenever we switch on your Bluetooth, then meaning of this one is, yes, that addresses show to the others also who are nearer to the that particular device. So that address only you call as a BD address. It is a 48 bit MAC address, and in that first 24 bits you are used to identify the device manufacturer and model, and remaining 24 bits to instantiate. Okay, so switch on whenever you on that Bluetooth, no, that one you call as a discoverable mode. Means what? Your Bluetooth address is visible to the all others who have come in that particular range here. So now in this way, that attackers will get your address and they will transfer the file of the infected one here. This is one way. Even if you are not on the discover, you are not in your in a discoverable mode, then also it identify the your address by using the brute force technique here. Okay, brute force technique. And here for making communication, usually in the internet you are using the HTTP to send as a request and reply message, but here in Bluetooth you are using the object exchange as a protocol to exchange the files or inform messages from one mobile to another mobile here. So now here attacker A uses OBX push to transfer a file containing a malicious code to user B here. So usually in the user B, even if they want to access, even it is not received by the user B, if this one is disabled, okay, authorization required. Okay, for any file if you are received from the Bluetooth enabled devices, so this required authorization is required. Means what? Without your permission it is not allowed to infect or receive the that particular file to the user B here. So that's why here for that providing the security here. Okay, so now authorization procedure, if it is there, then you can prevent from attacking the things here. So for that, this is the one example. Here in the Bluetooth you are using the link level security. Link level security means what? First assume that here two devices A and B want to communicate here. For communicating A, BA address of the A and BA address of the B here. These two want to communicate now. Communicate means what? These two want to transfer the files here. For that, first this A will generate a random number, and that random number it transfer to the address, that is the B device also. So next, with the help of the address of the device A and address of the device B, they will use one number as a pin. That pin number is mutually exchanged earlier before making communication offline. This number is already mutually it is exchanged, and with the help of this pseudo random number and address of the A device and address of the B device, it will encrypt the message here. So for encrypting, you are using as a one of the encryption algorithm like a E22. Then you will get one key. That key what you call key initialization key here. This key initialization key you call as a share link key, and this key you are using for the purpose here. With the help of this key initialization key, you will get a key AB and KAB. So this is the key you are using so while transferring the messages here. How it is, let's see. LKRAND A, this is the random nouns is generated by A, and this is the random nouns generated by B, and this one is XORed with the key initialization. You already got that key initialization in this stage, and that initialization key is XORed, and after that what are the output you will get? No, that one you are transferring to the device B. In the same way, device B also transfer the that random key with the key initialization value, it transferred to the device A here. After receiving that, this one it is XORed with the key initialization, and what are the result we will get? No, that one it is encrypted using E21, and address of the device A is also encrypted, and these two encrypted messages are XORed, then you will get a KAB here. Same procedure it is performed here also, then it will, here you are using the KAB. So this is the key it is used for encrypting the files here before transferring here. So here for example, A and B want to communicate. For that, first A will send the random as a challenge, okay, and whenever B will receive no, for that it encrypts using a key. That key is already both the devices having this link key and address of the B, and it forward as a response to A here. Whenever A receive that one, it decrypts, and after decrypting what are the random number you will get? No, if it is same, in this way both will authenticate, and afterwards they will make the communication here. Next last one, that is the botnet. Botnet means what it is? It is an army of a compromised computers or boots connected to the internet or remotely controlled by the bootmaster. So bootmaster means what it is? It is a collection of zombies that has participated in denial of service attack. Continuously you are sending the request to the subsystems here. Okay. So that is what you call as a denial of service attack, and even you are getting the spam mails. Okay. With the help of this one, you are attacking the botnet here. So in the botnet, what is the thing it will do? No, it perform a program. That program, okay, what are the program will add? No, that program with the help of the spam mail or DDoS, denial of service attack, it attacks the victims, and then that victim, now this program is there, and this program, okay, it contain what? Keyloggers. Keyloggers means what? Monitoring of the system, or what are the, while browsing, what are the things you will type from the keyboard, everything it is absorbed by this botnet. And another one is the spyware. Spyware means what it is? It absorbs the all sensitive information like your password, credit card numbers during browsing, and send this to the bootmaster. So whenever bootmaster get those information, no, it keep with it. And for example, if you want your system, okay, even it control the your system also, your password for your system, what are the password you are use, no, that password may be changed by this bootmaster, and your system is now under the control of this bootmaster. If you want your password back, your credit card number back, or any information from your system if you want back, no, then you have to pay some amount to this bootmaster, then only it allow you to use your information. That is what you call as a botnet attack here. So here it uses the open file shares and internet relay chat here. So with the help of this one, it multicast the messages to spread among the different machines. So this is about the different types of the malicious functions, and these are the programs actually used by the attackers to harm the different machines here. Is it clear now? Thank you.